Hey guys, Tori here from Overlook Horizon. Today, I'm at the National Weather Service here in Buffalo, New York. We're gonna launch a weather balloon. Let's check it out. National Weather Service launches 70,000 weather balloons every single year from airports and weather stations all across the United States. Here at the Buffalo Niagara International Airport, it's twice a day, every day at 6 a.m. and 6 p.m. Launching a weather balloon on a clear day with ideal conditions is hard enough for us. Today would definitely be a no-go launch for us because we've got dark skies, wind, rain. It's crazy. There's no way we'd be launching a weather balloon today, but hey, these guys are pros. They can handle it.
This is Dan Kelly, a meteorologist for the National Weather Service and the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. He's our guide today, showing us just how the National Weather Service prepares and launches their regular weather balloon flights every day. Most of the flights that the National Weather Service performs are for radiosondes. That's the white instrumentation package that Dan's holding. It has everything needed to measure the atmospheric temperature, pressure, and humidity, along with its position, and it will transmit all that data back to Dan in 1 second increments during the ascent phase of the flight. The LMS-6 radio sonde is a precisely calibrated instrument made by Lockheed Martin, and the National Weather Service typically uses a 600-gram Caimont Totex weather balloon to fly them. With the payload being only about 500 grams, that can get their flight pretty close to 100,000 feet each time. Helium is the preferred lifting gas for the Buffalo, New York station, as it's a much safer gas to work with. Other stations still use hydrogen with extreme safety procedures. Just like our flights, they have an inline parachute attached between the balloon and the payload that automatically deploys when the balloon bursts. One of the amazing advantages that they have over us is that all of their flights are prepared indoors, which makes filling the balloon much easier since they don't have to worry about wind or other weather conditions during filling. These balloons go up in almost any conditions except when there's lightning within a few miles, so having a protected shelter for most of their work makes preparation a breeze. One really amazing tool that they have that I wish we had is this weighted automatic gas shutoff valve. They place the exact lift weight that they want on the valve, and once the balloon pulls up with that force, the gas automatically shuts off and stops filling the balloon. The payloads are not recovered by the National Weather Service, so the average person can come across these harmless instruments from time to time. They all contain a self-addressed prepaid envelope to return the device for refurbishing. The instruments are put through a quick calibration check to make sure they're all operating as they should. Once that's verified, it's time to tie off the balloon. Just before launch, Dan coordinates with the Buffalo Air Traffic Control Tower to quickly verify that it's safe to launch. These flights are pretty routine for these guys, so there's not much fanfare when it comes to launch time. The doors open and it's time to fly. The red light you see is a small glow stick used to help aircraft see the flight as it's departing the airport's traffic area. Once the flight is launched, their computer systems immediately begin receiving and calculating their data. A skew T graph is constructed in real time while the balloon is flying. Once the payload readings drop to a pressure level of 400 millibars or roughly 24,000 feet, the flight is considered a success, and they then send their partial sounding data to be used in our forecast models. Most of the flights, though, will continue on to about 100,000 feet above sea level, which is around 10 millibars of pressure, and completed sounding files will then be provided for forecasts when the flight is over. While we waited for the flight to finish, Dan showed me some of the older World War II era methods like this theodolite that was used before radio and GPS systems took over in the 80s. Once the balloon bursts, the flight is over for them. Their computer systems automatically shut down and stop recording data. The exact landing location is not usually tracked.
Thanks for watching today's video. If you liked it, don't forget to hit that thumbs up button. Also, be sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel so you don't miss any of our flights coming up this spring. And in case you didn't notice, I'm growing a little mustache this month. That's in support of the Movember Foundation charity. Every November, I grow a mustache to help support prostate cancer research. If you can, even a small donation makes a big difference. There's a link in the description below if you'd like to contribute. Thanks again for watching. We'll see you in the next video.